Thank you all for being here. It's a hot night. We tried to cool it down the best we can, and as it gets cooler this evening, we think it'll get more comfortable. But in any event, we know you'll have a fabulous evening. I'm thrilled to welcome Diane Rehm here tonight. It's really a pleasure. And did you know that it's her very first visit to Martha's Vineyard? But it won't be her last. And we also heard a rumor that she's going to a neighboring island after... or they call the sandbar out in the water. Anyway, for all of us, meeting Diane Rehm is like meeting a family member that we know, that we are very close to, but we've never seen, that we talk to on the phone all the time, we have a conversation with, but we actually don't see. So it's thrilling to see her in person. She knew radio was hip before we knew it. You know, now podcasts, radio is the in thing. But Diane was well before her time. I think she's been on the air for 37 years. And she will retire at the end of this year, but I'm sure you'll hear more about that. Geraldine Brooks could not be here tonight. An emergency came up, but she was the force that suggested it, so a big thank you to her for suggesting it. This island, as many places, faces the issue of aging and end-of-life issues, so it's particularly relevant to this, to the community here, we thought, to have a discussion, the kind of discussion that Diane, in her book On My Own, takes us into. I wanted to mention this is the second to last event in our series. We will finish on Sunday night with Jane Mayer. And the tickets were close to sold out for that, so if you're interested, please do buy tickets. She'll be interviewed by Tony Horowitz. And if you've read her recent article on Tony Schwartz, Trump's ghostwriter, you'll be particularly interested in the discussion, I think, on Sunday night. Next summer is the Martha's Vineyard Book Festival, and the dates are August 5th and 6th, so the weekend is set, and we hope you'll mark your calendars and be sure to schedule your vacation so you're here then. Thank you. I'd like to take a minute to thank our sponsors, our wonderful, amazing newspaper, the Vineyard Gazette is here today. Jane Seagrave, Mark. we couldn't do it without them. The coverage that they give to the series, the ads that they run for us, their support makes it all possible. And it's how you know about it. When I did a survey the other day about how many people knew about us because of the articles or ads in the Gazette, that was the dominant force. So thanks so much to the Gazette. WBUR-FM is also our sponsor. Bunch of Grapes, of course, who is Johnny on the spot and was with Diane earlier today and here again today. So we are all about supporting booksellers and purchasing hard books and supporting authors and publishers. So, you know, as you know, the ticket price is geared to give you a discount on admission, so you'll buy a book. And even if you like ebooks, you prefer ebooks, we encourage you to please buy a book and give it to a friend, and then download the ebook later. So, the Chilmark Town Affairs Council, the Chilmark Community Center, our umbrella organization, and a great supporter. They make it all possible. We couldn't do it without their auspices. And many of the volunteers, the young people who help here, the people in the parking lot or moving the chairs, their center staff, and do a terrific job for us. We have grant funding for the permanent endowment from Martha's Vineyard, and from the Martha's Vineyard Savings Bank Charitable Fund. And of course, we have individual sponsors that go a long way and help us bring the authors here. So thank you to our sponsors. I wanted to now tell you a little bit about who will be interviewing Diane Rehm tonight. We're thrilled and delighted to have Alexandra Styron. Alexandra is a member of our of the book festival and the author series advisory panel. She's the author of the very fine memoir, Reading My Father. The memoir gives the perspective of the youngest child of William Styron, and she's also the author of the novel All the Finest Girls. She's a graduate of the MFA program at Columbia University, and her work has appeared in the New Yorker, New York Times, Vanity Fair, the Financial Times, and the Wall Street Journal. She teaches memoir writing at Hunter College. She lives in New York with her two children and her husband, but she also spends as much time as possible on Martha's Vineyard. And she's been a great supporter of the series and proposing authors and always doing the best interviews. So let me welcome them both on the stage, Diane and Alexandra. I want to mention two things, or three things. First of all, is Anne Graham here? Okay, will you meet me in back? That's one thing. The second thing is, if you look in back, you see Dan Martino, who's videoing it. And Dan, we video all of these so we can preserve them. And Dan does a fantastic job in being here and making sure every minute is recorded so you can see it later. So thank you to Dan. And also, Melissa Patterson is here. You see this beautiful sign. You've seen all of our signage. Melissa Patterson is the graphic designer from About Signs Empty. She makes us look way more clever and together than we really are. So thank you to them.
Thank you, Sue Ellen. And thank you to the Martha's Vineyard Gazette and all the people at the Martha's Vineyard Book Festival and the author series who promote books and provoke thought and entertain us all every summer. So thank you, Sue Ellen. I think you can imagine it's only a little intimidating to interview Diane Rehm. So I hope you'll all forgive me. I am not an interviewer. I am essentially at the feet of a master. So I will do my best and muddle through. I think, as Sue Ellen said, everybody feels like they know you, Diane. So in some ways it feels silly to be even making an introduction, but I'm going to make a proper introduction because that's what you're supposed to do. Diane Rehm has hosted the Diane Rehm Show on WAMU 88.5 FM in Washington, D.C., distributed by NPR since 1979. The show has a weekly listening audience of 2.5 million. Currently, it is broadcast on nearly 200 stations and Sirius satellite radio across the country, as well as internationally by Armed Forces Radio Network. She lives in Washington, D.C. Diane has written three memoirs, yes?
Three memoirs and a book about my dog.
And a book about your dog. I kind of consider that a memoir, since we are our dogs in some way.
True.
Her most recent book, On My Own, which I hope you'll all get or have already gotten, was published this year by Knopf. And I asked Diane to read a few pages to you all because I felt like the essential Diane Rehm is Diane and her speaking to all of us. So she's going to read a few pages and then we'll talk. Yeah?
First, Alexandra, thank you so much for doing this.
You see? She is the consummate interviewer.
It's really lovely to be here on the island for the very first time and to be... and to be welcomed by so many of you. Thank you for being here. Now, shall I read a little bit?
Yeah, that'd be great.
All right. I'm going to read from the beginning of the book, and as Carol Goldberg so kindly pointed out tonight, I have read the book for distribution, and it came out at the same time that the book did. The first chapter is titled, and we didn't even call them chapters. We didn't even number them as chapters because it was kind of an ongoing dialogue with myself. And that's how I began to write this. The night John was dying, and I knew he was close to death, I stayed at his residence on two chairs next to his bed with my hand on his arm and my dog on my stomach. Little dog only weighs 8 pounds. He's a long-haired chihuahua. But at about 2:30 in the morning, you can't sleep on two chairs. So I got up, I had my iPad with me, and I just began writing. I didn't know what I was going to write or how I was going to write. I just wanted to write. So I shall begin with a decision. On June 14, 2014, my husband John Rehm, aged 83, began his withdrawal from life. The aides at Brighton Gardens were instructed to stop bringing medications, menus, or water. His decision to die came after a long and difficult conversation the day before with his doctor, our son David, our daughter Jennifer, who was on the phone from Boston, and me. John declared to our doctor that because Parkinson's disease had so affected him that he no longer had the use of his hands, arms, or legs, because he could no longer stand, walk, eat, bathe, or in any way care for himself on his own, he was now ready to die. He said he understood the disease was progressing, taking him further and further into incapacity with no hope of improvement. Therefore, he wanted to end his life. Clearly, his expectation and his misunderstanding was that now that he had made his decision, he could simply be put to sleep with medication. When his doctor explained he was unable to carry out John's wishes, that he was prohibited from committing such an act in the state of Maryland, John became very angry. He said, "I feel betrayed." Tears came into his eyes, tears of frustration and disappointment. Here was a man who had lived his life able, for the most part, to take charge of events, to be certain that his well-considered decisions would be carried out. And now he was making the ultimate decision and having it thwarted. I rage at a system that would not allow John to be helped toward his own death. He was of rational mind, with no hope of recovery, knowing full well that the only way ahead was a slow downward slide, moving more and more toward incapacity and even greater indignity. Why should it be that only a few states allow the ultimate gift? Why should my husband have to starve himself to death? I wondered too why John should have had to be so alone in the dying process. I cry at the loss of what might have been this final intimacy between us, replaced by a long descent into oblivion, unaware of his family and friends beside him, offering him a loving farewell and a peaceful journey.
Beautiful. Thank you. That, I think, gives you a taste of how, of this really beautiful and brave book, which I think you'll all find when you read it. I know that this experience has been transformative, obviously, in a lot of ways, and that you've become essentially a kind of leading voice in the conversation about the right to die. I know you featured the subject on your show several times, and particularly when the Brittany Maynard story in Oregon was sort of dominating the conversation.
She was the true hero.
Yeah. And was that coinciding with your father?
Came just before your husband's
illness.
Yes.
So maybe you could help us, since this has become such a significant issue in your life, for us to understand how you think the issue is evolving, both philosophically and politically, in the country.
Well, California recently made the decision, after a long battle within the state legislature, it was turned down the first time, and then the California Medical Association decided not to oppose it, but simply to step aside and remain neutral on the issue. And with that neutrality, the legislature passed the Death with Dignity bill the second time. And what was so fascinating to me was that Governor Jerry Brown, in his signing statement, and here I am paraphrasing, said something to the effect that, I do not know, and this, mind you, is a Jesuit-trained man. He said, I do not know what I will do when the end comes. What I do know is that I would not want someone else to make that decision for me. And that is the heart of my argument, if you will, that in fact, if you believe that God should be the only entity to decide when you go, I support you 1,000%. If you decide that despite pain, despite suffering, despite treatment after treatment, that you want to continue with any and all treatments, I support you 1,000%. And if you decide that now is when you are finished with your suffering. I support your right to say that to a physician and to have that physician help you in whatever way the law will allow, state to state. Now, currently, what that means is that a physician can provide you with medication, but cannot be present when and if you decide to take that medication. It's so fascinating to me that in Oregon, the first state that approved the right to die, that only 2/3 of those who've been given the medication have decided to use it. It is the empowerment. It is the reality that if I choose to go or if I choose to stay, the decision is mine. It is my right to choose, and that is what I am arguing for. Now, New York State is also debating this. State of Maryland, state of Colorado. Right now, you have only 5 states that have approved it. I think California could, might be a tipping point, Alex.
I know that you've had people on both sides of the argument.
Yes.
On your show.
Yes.
Dr. Byock, you've had on more than once?
Oh, yes.
Yes,
absolutely.
Quite a few times. What is your... what's your response to that side of the argument, and do you feel like that sort of the nuance of the other side is something that you can respect and get behind, or do you find yourself in a kind of forceful position against the physician, a physician's perspective?
Oh, no, I totally understand a physician's perspective who says, you know, we were taught to do no harm, and therefore I, as a physician, cannot enter into this situation with a patient. But I am also arguing that in medical schools across the country, there must be more dialogue. There must be more conversation. And my daughter is a doctor. My son-in-law is a doctor. And when my daughter was on the telephone during that conversation with my husband, she said into the phone, "But Dad, we can keep you comfortable." And John said, "I don't want comfort. I am ready to die." So that perspective, Alex, must be respected, but at the same time, I do strongly believe that because doctors are taught from the outset, do no harm, that there is not sufficient discussion within medical schools. And by the way, Harvard has just begun a program on this issue for medical students, how to hear better what a patient is asking for at the end of life.
What do you say to people whose sort of point of view about this issue is a faith-based point of view? I feel like there is a large part of our culture that is very attached to a kind of, you know, insistence of life, you know, whether it's anti-abortion or not being comfortable with the right to die movement, that the idea is that there's sanctity of life and that no one should ever be allowed to make that choice. And that it often tends to sort of, the place where that falls down sometimes is with the death penalty, that it is that's the place where all of a sudden the sanctity of life is no longer applicable. So I wonder what you say to the folks who approach it from that perspective.
I think those who approach it from that perspective should be allowed to step back from it. Mm-hmm. Because I do believe that choice, individual choice, is both for doctors, for patients, for parents. I am an outspoken pro-choice person, and I've said that publicly on the air, and I certainly say it here again now. I am for choice at the beginning of life. I am for choice at the end of life. I think that each of us is the keeper of our own bodies. And we certainly, as women, have that right under the Constitution. And we, at the end of life, men or women, should also have that right. Thank you.
If I can sort of extrapolate from that or pivot from that to the issue of doing the job you do and making an effort to maintain some objectivity, I imagine that a subject, it's tricky as a journalist to be looking at a subject from the outside and then find yourself deep inside it. And I wonder how you have surfed that wave of your convictions coming up against your journalistic integrity.
When I do programs, which I'm loath to do, on abortion, on gun rights, on Israel, and the Palestinians, I work very hard to maintain my neutrality on the air. I am of Arab descent, which many of you may not know. My mother and father were both born in Mersin, Turkey, before Syria even existed. My father's family then went to Beirut, Lebanon. My mother's family went to Alexandria, Egypt. And my father's family came here in 1907. My father went back to Alexandria in 1929 and plucked my mother from an engagement to another man and brought her here to this country. He had his entire family with him. She had no one. And I think it was very, very hard for her. She finished eighth grade. My father graduated from high school. His English was better. She was very shy and withdrawn. She died at 49. When I was 19, my father, 13 years older than she, died of a broken heart 11 months later. So I think about that a lot, and she begged to die at the last. She begged to die because she had liver disease, though she and my dad had one shot on Christmas and one shot on New Year's, and that was it. But at the end of her life, she looked as though she was 11 months pregnant. and she was 49, and I got there 20 minutes too late, as I did with John, which made me very sad. So neutrality is key when I am in that chair, Alex.
And now, so when you say you kind of hate doing interviews.
I hate those
You hate
programs.
Them because you want, because what you really want to do is stand up and
yeah,
say.
Exactly, exactly. And it's very hard. And of course, after the Washington Post published a big headline story called Rehm Becomes the Voice of Choice in Dying, the NPR folks all came to WAMU, right. And I mean, it was a big hoopla saying, you know, you can't do this. And I said, well, I'm going to do it for a
yeah.
while. And we got through it.
So this leads me to my next question, which is also about objectivity in the media. We are living in extraordinary times in an extraordinary
yes, indeed.
Year. I know today Susan Page was covering for you and your show, and she did, the show was about...
That was the program I wanted to do.
So,
I suggested
okay.
it yesterday.
Okay, so because I actually want to hear your perspective on this, in case you missed the show today, because why would you listen if Diane wasn't doing it? It was about objectivity in the media during the era of Donald Trump and how journalists continue to do their job as they're supposed to.
And
how, take it away.
And how in an era of Donald Trump journalists should be required to do their jobs. My friend Gardner Harris, who is the White House correspondent for the New York Times, is here with me. I've known him since he was about 10 years old, and now he's about this tall and on the front page at the New York Times. His newspaper had a wonderful piece the other day by a reporter questioning himself and saying, how can we as honest journalists cover this man who tells lie after lie, who contradicts himself, who uses the worst possible language in calling out others, who really gives every journalist in the country a tough, tough deal with which to maneuver. And so last Monday, I came in and said, you know, we've got to cover this because every journalist in the country is worried about how you do this. And how you maintain an objectivity when, you know, the Washington Post gives 4 Pinocchios here and 5 Pinocchios there, and fact checkers go over and over, and, you know, it's hard to say, but on balance, of course, Mr. Trump did say this. I mean, it's really hard. And so yesterday on the air, after he had said something about those who Second Amendment followers, well, maybe they could do something. I mean, the fellows and the woman who came onto my program sort of tried to tamp that down. And I said, you can't. It's outrageous for this man to say this. It's outrageous. And we've got to call him out. That's all there is to it. So that's, you know, my passions do come in, and I'm not afraid to let them fly.
Yeah. So what do you tell journalists who are younger and coming up and not in the same position you are? You have the kind of gravitas and authority to be able to say whatever the hell you want, as well you should. But I wonder if we are...
But Alex, I'm a talk show host. I'm a talk show host. I'm not somebody who's writing for the front page
right.
of the New York Times. Though that journalist did, in fact, question himself
mm-hmm.
and his ability to cover a person like Donald Trump with objectivity. So my advice to young journalists is seek the truth.
Yeah.
State the truth.
Yeah.
And try to garner as many opinions and thoughts and try to dig as deep into yourself as you possibly can before you write or before you speak. And I've dug for almost 38 years now, and it's time for me to speak out. Absolutely. Thank you.
So I just want to bring up probably a little bit of a sensitive subject, but I think you should talk about it, which ties into this subject, which is that last year, as I'm sure many of you know, Diane did an interview with Bernie Sanders and had it was an unfortunate experience. And I think it's interesting to bring up because to me, what the... I'm sure all of you know this story, but Diane had seen. No, okay. Do you want to? Why don't you
sure.
tell it,
I'll
and
tell
then I'll
story.
Say I'll ask my question
okay.
that goes to
all right.
what you're.
I had a piece of paper in front of me, which said that Bernie Sanders had dual citizenship in the United States and in Israel. I wrote about this in my book because it is my humiliation that I will live with for the rest of my life. Worst mistake I've ever made. When I saw that statement on paper, I questioned it. I asked about it. I said, let's check it. And check it, and check it. I went on the air with it. And the senator was on the program with me, and we had been having a wonderful conversation. And instead of asking the question, stupid me said, Senator, you are a dual citizen of both the United States and Israel. And he immediately said, no, that's not true. That's never been true. And stupid me followed and said, I have a list here. And that list, you may want to know, contained the names of almost every major official in the U.S. government. I mean, that's how bad that kind of stuff can get pushed. And he said, no, Diane, you're absolutely wrong. And I immediately apologized. And after I got off the air, I sent an email to him immediately. And I said, I am mortified and so embarrassed. Please forgive me for having not done my job as a journalist. And his aide sent back, an email saying, Diane, the senator is not upset. He loves you and forgives you.
Him.
I don't forgive myself, but he forgave me, which was very generous.
What that story made me think about is not only what your audience and the general reader audience responds to and what we get in our newspapers and on the radio and TV, but that we're all deluged by information on the internet.
Of course.
And that line becomes, if it's not completely erased, it's been nearly erased by this onslaught of unchecked information.
Right.
So the criticism you've given yourself suggests that, and we would all hope that we would have journalists and talk show hosts who do that for us, but how we manage this deluge of information is, seems to me, almost impossible, and it's why someone like Donald Trump, I think, generates the kind of power he generates, because the people who are taking in the information are taking it in from sources that are unchecked. They take it in without hearing the balanced other side, and I wonder what you imagine we can do to manage that kind of information onslaught and know where the truth lies.
Alex, I worry more about the children than I do about the adults. I worry about us a lot, but I worry about the children even more. You and I might see something and question it, but they receive images, information, and do not question. They do not realize that, unlike the New York Times, the Washington Post, right, the Wall Street Journal, who all make mistakes as well, let me say that, but nevertheless, the editorial process is what is so important. The fact checkers, the people who are looking at each and every phrase to ensure that that which is going into a major newspaper is truthful. No such editing process online. It's just, yeah, right, as you said, right, an onslaught. And we're going to have to winnow down those sources to which we turn and in which we offer our trust.
Yeah. I wonder if you would just step us through a little bit. I think it's always interesting to know how, with a show like yours, with the volume that you do and the amount of information that you sift through and that you bring your audience, how a little bit about how the process is created, how the sausage is made, so to speak.
Well, let me say first that there are 5 full-time and 3 part-time producers working with me. Without them, I could not do my job. The bane of my existence is getting up every morning at 5 a.m. I literally hate doing that. As soon as my clock radio goes on, the dog begins to bark. And between the radio and the dog barking at 5 a.m., I have no choice. I have to get out of bed. And I then, walk him at about 5:30 in the morning, even before the sun comes up. I'm in the office by about 8. The producers have got that first, I should tell you that 2 hours a day, the first hour is always focused on the latest news story, which is why this morning was on how news is covered as far as Trump is concerned. The second hour is a softer hour. If I weren't doing the show, maybe I'd have been on the program on my own book on the second hour. No such luck, because we do sell a lot of books. So the first hour is planned 24 hours in advance. We meet, my producers and I, every morning at between 8:15 and 8:30. And in the rotation, whichever producer has the responsibility for the next day comes in with, say, four or five ideas, and then we go around the room, and whichever idea rises to the top is the one she takes on. She works on that show all day long and may leave the office finally at 7:30, 8 o'clock at night. I get her script at about 8:45 that morning. I have to go downstairs to start pre-recording billboards and promos at 9:15. So basically, I've got a half hour to prepare to do that first hour on the air. But their preparation for me is so wonderful that it just goes right into my brain, and I get on the air, and I know what I'm doing. I know where I'm going to go. I know how to do it. I know to whom I'm going to go. I know when I'm going to bring the audience in. I know who thinks what and what their positions are. That's been made very clear to me in each of the scripts. And so it's a labor of love, but it's a labor that is not all mine. Right. It is, right. It could not be done without those producers.
So you hate... Yes.
So then I'm there until about 2:30 in the afternoon, and my dog is with me under my desk. And
I was going to ask about the dog.
Yeah, I take him home because he's a nipper. he's a beautiful little long-haired old black chihuahua. But any of you who knows chihuahuas may know that they're not the friendliest dogs in the whole wide world. And if you put your hand down to pet him, he'll bite your finger. So my door is always closed when I'm downstairs, so nobody goes in there. So I go home, and because I am up at 5, I try to get to bed by 9:30, but, you know, you're out a lot.
Right. And right. So I don't think it's a secret probably to a lot of people here that you are hanging up your microphone, so to speak.
I am going to step away from the microphone at the end of the year, but I am not retiring. I'm staying at the station. I'm moving up one floor. My whole desk outline, everything is going to be shifted to the floor upstairs, an identical office to mine. I'm going to help to raise money for this station. I'm going to continue to speak out about the right to die and the right to choose. I'm going to be traveling the country more for the book, and I think I'll be busy.
Good.
I think I'll be busy.
I think you'll be busy, too. Yeah. You interviewed Mr. Rogers once, and you asked him what he did when he was sad, right?
I did.
And he said, I play the piano.
He was in, I should back up and tell you, I was a homemaker for 14 years when John and I got married. You know, I had no ambition. I had been a secretary at State Department, which was how he and I met. He was an attorney doing trade work with my boss, and we both loved baseball. I played for the women's team. He played for the men's team. I was a good second baseman. And eventually we got to talking about other things than baseball. And when we married, I really thought, you know, I'd just stay home, raise children, entertain. But long about when the kids were 13 and 10, I started realizing that they were going to be gone before I knew it. And I had read Betty Friedan's book, and I began thinking about what might lie ahead for me. I really had no idea. I took a class called New Horizons for Women at GW, and people said to me, oh, you really ought to be in broadcasting. I don't know why they said that, but anyhow, they did. And within a week, somebody had told me about this volunteer situation at this tiny little station that went off the air when you went off the curb at American University. And I volunteered there. And the first day I showed up as a volunteer instead of being met by the host who had interviewed me, I was met by the female manager of the station who said to me, oh, you must be the new volunteer. I'm sorry to tell you, the host is out sick. So I thought she was going to tell me to, you know, hightail it and go back home. Instead, she said, so I, the manager, am going to have to do the program, and I'd like you to come into the studio with me. For 90 minutes, we together interviewed a representative of the Dairy Council. Now, you know, as a mother, as a homemaker, I knew lots about butter and meat and milk and that sort of thing. And I was frankly convinced that the Department of Agriculture had the food pyramid all wrong. And so I challenged her, and, you know, and that was the first day on the air. And I've been there ever since. What can I say? So Mr. Rogers was someone I saved my ironing for. So at every afternoon, I had all the ironing to do as a homemaker, and I'd sit my kids down in front of me because I believed then, and I continue to believe, that Mr. Rogers was probably the greatest teacher of what it is to be a human being. A kind human being that I have ever known in my life. And so I said to him, do you ever get sad? He was in Pittsburgh. He was playing the piano, doing all of these meow, meow voices and playing. And I said, do you ever get sad? And he said, well, yes, I do. And I said, well, what do you do when you get sad? And he said, I play the piano a lot. And he said, I think I'll be playing the piano a great deal today. And I said, well, why are you sad? And he said, all this is taking place on the air, mind you. And he said, because my stomach hurts. And I did not have the courage to ask, why does your stomach hurt? And he was dead 3 months later. Mine was the last live interview he did. And 2 days after that interview, I received in the mail a tiny little book with a mirror on the front. And the book is titled, You Are Special. And you open it, and Mr. Rogers had written, you really are special, Diane. I love you, Fred Rogers. And I had that on my nightstand all these years. Ask me about my worst interview.
Okay. I had that on here, but she's so teaching me how to be an interviewer. I really had that question.
I have to tell you this story. So how many of you know and probably love the books of Tom Clancy? Okay. So years and years ago, obviously before he died, Tom Clancy came into the studio. I went out to greet him, put my hand out to shake his hand. He had dark aviator glasses on. And when I put out my hand, he didn't put out his. And I thought, well, maybe he doesn't see my hand out or whatever. So I take him into the studio. He still doesn't take his glasses off. So I had read his book very carefully. And even before we began the interview, not only does he not take his glasses off, he puts his elbow on the table and puts his hand over his eyes like this. So he clearly doesn't even want to look at me. So I'm thinking, maybe the light's bothering him. I don't know what his problem is. And I had read the book very carefully. So I gave him a really good question, one he could expound on. His answer was, yep. So I'm thinking, well, I better give him a heck of a second good question. And I did. And his answer was, nope. So I'm looking at the clock. And I'm thinking, I have two choices here. I can either say to him, Mr. Clancy, it's clear you'd rather not be here. So why don't you just leave and I'll open the phones and I'll talk to the listeners. Or maybe he's got a problem with me or women or whatever, and he didn't like being there. So I thought, well, I'll just open the phones, and maybe he'll enjoy talking with listeners. Thank goodness I decided on the second course of action. So I opened the phones. First caller, a gentleman, who begins by saying, Mr. Clancy, we love your books. And Clancy is smiling. And then the guy goes on to say, but you sure are being arrogant with our Diane. And Clancy throws Fantastic. His glasses on the table and says, "Oh, no, we're having a wonderful time, aren't we, Diane?" And the guy on the phone says, "It sure doesn't sound that way to us, Mr. Clancy." And from then on, he was a pussycat. So I don't know what the lessons that are of that. And whether you can draw any, but he was the worst.
Well, I think that
the worst.
The lesson is that you are incredibly resourceful and you're Diane Rehm. So I had lots of other great questions that you would have thought were such terrific questions for an interviewer to ask. I know, you would have told me later. But I also know that part of the show is always you. So
good.
It's time to open it up to all of you. I'm sure you have
open
questions.
Open the phones.
Open
and
the
phone. She has a microphone. Don't be bashful.
I adore you. I think I speak for all of us. I want to go back to the facts conversation and the journalism thing.
Can you hold that microphone
yes, ma'am.
Closer? Thank you.
I sure can. I want to go back to the conversation about facts, because what is really disturbing to me is that we don't live in a world where we can agree on facts, and I don't know what to do about that, and I want to know what to do about that. And yesterday I read an article in the New York Times, I think, that said that research shows that the more you assert at someone your version of the facts, the more they entrench in theirs. And, you know, there was a time when we could hold these truths to be self-evident, and now there isn't that anymore. And so I'd just like to know your advice on, you know, I mean, we can vent all we want to, but what are actions, what are things that you believe that we can do as individuals in families where we don't share facts in common?
Yes. I think that's such a good question, because this political campaign, most especially, has divided even families. And I think that that is very, very difficult to get through. All I can say, and I've encountered this, not my own family, thank heavens, but in speaking, I live in a condo with 242 units. And I can assure you that there are many, many different ideas, perspectives, versions of the truth. And what I have decided for myself in those personal situations is to continue to listen as hard as I can to that other person's perspective, and then, rather than stating my own perspective, to ask questions. I think you will, by asking those questions, get to the heart of what that person is feeling. I'm not sure you're going to change minds, because people have gotten very entrenched, especially during this period. But I think if you can understand the rationale that is causing that person, that stranger, that family member to come to those conclusions, and then move on. A friend of mine said to me the other day, he went to visit his sister and had driven a few hours to get to her, and knew that her political perspective was totally different from his. And when she began talking, he just quieted down. I'm not sure that people can be convinced of another idea if they are embedded in their own. So I think all we can do is to see if we can find out more, state our own positions quietly, ask questions, and try to have a rational conversation. It ain't easy.
I was wondering.
I can't hear you. If you
closer,
that's
like this.
It.
Okay. I was wondering whether you had any thoughts about similarities and differences between the right to die and the issues, involved in the right to choose. They seem strangely similar, but also different. The decision to end a life or a potential life?
The one thing I would say, and I'm sure that those who argue that any abortion is wrong, is that another human life is involved. Whereas when I decide to die, it will be my life and no one else's. Whereas with abortion, we are dealing with a fetus. And I would argue that a woman has the right to choose for her own body. However, those who would argue a different way would say that fetus at viability or whenever has no choice. I think that that's the argument that is made between the difference. Frankly, I see them as quite similar. But I think those who don't feel that way would argue in another way. Right, exactly. It's her body. It's her body.
Thank you. I hope this isn't the last time you're on the Vineyard. It's great that you're here.
I can't hear you.
Okay. Good. I was hoping you could speak a little more about the book and perhaps any takeaways or advice you have for other people who are on their own.
Let me clarify. Do you mean for those of us who have been left behind?
Yes.
John and I never talked about this. We talked a great deal about many, many other things, but he never said to me, I hope you will not be alone for the rest of your life, nor did I ever say to him, should I die first, I hope you will not be alone. I always believed that he had longevity on his side. His mother took her own life at age 92. I never thought I'd be alone. I think the one thing that I really honestly do believe is that life goes on and that we must make a life for ourselves. And though I am leaving the microphone at the end of the year, I am going to continue to be involved in work life as long as I live and as long as I am healthy and can contribute. And, I think people often say to me, will there ever be another relationship? Will there ever be a new life in that way? How do I know? I have no idea. I certainly, because I feel I am healthy, but I am almost 80 years old and will be in September. I feel as though I need to be thoughtful and cautious as I move ahead. But I also want to be as open to all possibilities in my life as I can. Thank you.
So on a lighter note, if I may, we have a tradition here in Chilmark called Sunday morning softball. It's been around since the late 30s, believe it or not. And if you happen to be here Sunday morning, hold on, we could use a second baseman.
Thank you. If I tried to swing a bat, I'd probably throw my back out at this age.
Well, I'm almost 80 also.
Good for you. Good for you. Good for you.
Hi, it is such an honor to be in your presence.
Oh, thank you.
I am just so touched. It never ceases to amaze me the intelligence and eloquence and thoughtfulness of your callers that call in. And I just am forever curious, how can you possibly screen them, or do you? And have you ever had people that you just either erased or somehow blocked? Is it a problem?
Well, there are two processes which are constantly at work. The first is there is a wonderful woman who takes the calls as they come. And unless somebody seems totally off the mark, she will put that caller's name, where they're from, and about six words about what they want to say. Now, at the same time, one of my producers is taking emails, and they're up on my computer screen as well. There are also tweets and Facebook postings, and I'm reading all of this while I'm talking to my guests, believe it or not. So my mind is scrambling over all of this. What I am attempting to do is to work in a caller where that caller fits in the conversation, so that when the conversation begins, we're up here, and by the time the hour ends, I want you, the listener, to have gotten something really cohesive. And callers are a wonderful part of that. And I think where callers fit is very important in that conversation, so that I would not take a caller who is so far out from where the conversation is or wants to go back to something else. I'm trying to work them in, but you're absolutely right. I think through the 38 years, people have realized that I don't fool around. And I have in my studio, that you all don't know about, something called a fader button. So that when I hear that caller begin to ramble, repeat, go a little too far, zap. And that's what makes them just really, really good. Sure.
If I could follow up a little more on the right to die statutes, Even the California statute doesn't really cover many, many people who are suffering, who would not seem to qualify, such as, for example, that they're terminally ill.
Quite right.
And all of the statutes are so vague that 90% of the people who might qualify don't. I just would like you to comment on that.
I don't believe that. You said 90% of those who might qualify don't. The issue is that in California, in Oregon, in Montana, in Vermont, you must have two doctors who agree that you are within 6 months of dying. You must then be interviewed by a psychiatrist to ensure that you are of sound mind and that you are indeed within 6 months of dying, which John had already been told he was. My belief is that pain and suffering should also qualify. I really do believe that because I don't think anyone else can measure someone else's pain. But look, think about how long the idea of same-sex marriage hung around before we finally got it moving, and California was the tipping point. I believe that this is the first step, and that as more states begin to accept this, there will be refinements to the law. Does that answer it?
Yes,
yes. Yeah, okay, thank you.
Wait, okay. Well, sadly, I think we've run out of time. It's been so wonderful having you here.
Oh, Alex, it's been my pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. That's lovely.